So the recording has started. We can begin. Audible?
Yes, you are audible, Pala. Yes, you are audible. The fact is that no one other can, other than the three of us, no one can actually speak up, right? Maybe okay, the chat section if we can.
Yeah, I'll be monitoring the chat section. So if any doubt you have, you can, all of you can write in the chat section.
Yeah, I'll share my screen. One second. Okay, so I hope my screen is visible and I am audible. Yes? Okay.
Yes, so, ma'am.
Yeah, so basically the agenda, like today will be the last session, and the agenda is going to be like how we will be going, like what we will be covering is, first of all, we'll be explaining you about a little bit about identity aware proxy. Honestly, it's very simple, so just a definition would do. Then a little bit about firewall, just like again what it is and all those things. Then Shubhankar will explain you all about subnets. And after subnets, we will be going to the virtual private cloud. So these are the theoretical concepts. And at the end of the session, like after understanding these, we all will be able to perform labs as well. Okay. So what is an identity, like we will start now. What is an identity aware proxy, first of all? So like this lab as well. So basically, let's say I have a web server and I have a URL to it. Okay. But in that, like for that URL, I only want anyone from the organization of, okay, let's assume this way. We all of us, like how many people are there? I guess 20. So all of us are developers. I have created a URL such that only the developers at DSC can access it. Okay, so you all must have, I have given you all a domain, organization domain of DSC. If you have that, you all can simply log in and access that website. Only those who have that domain can see. So basically anyone else, even those from VJTI organization or anyone from Gmail, like other organization, they like for them, the website will show that, okay, it's not possible for you to log in because you are not authorized or authenticated. Okay. So this is what identity aware proxy is. Okay. Give me a moment. So this is what identity aware proxy is basically. So for the demo purpose, we are not performing the lab, and the lab is very simple. I have the screenshots of the lab. So what happens is initially it asks me to create, like deploy this on some server, like some server. So once I have deployed it, this was the URL that I received, the above URL you all can see. So two things happened. Like this URL can be accessed literally from anywhere, from any account. Okay. So this was the same URL that I also accessed to my mobile phone, and I got the same output. So there was no check of like who is coming here. But let's say you are building this is a very simple app, but let's say you are building an organization, right? So you need only the authenticated people to come inside. Okay. So that's where like after doing this in the lab, this will be the first task. After doing this, you will have to make sure that you are adding a authentication. So basically it will be an internal authentication. So sort of like everyone with the DSC domain can come inside. So if I do internal, all the users within my organization will be able to access it. And then when I again, like I have written inside here that only this account can access it. Okay. So you all will see that in the lab. So if I do it, like now if I able, like I'll do it. So when I sign in with Google and like try to do login, I still don't have access to it because I haven't yet added the email ID that should be able to go inside this website. Okay. So this is where IAP comes in. Once I do that, after that, I'll be able to go inside this as well. So along with only giving me permission to go inside some website, what IAP also does is it basically helps me. You all can see that in like this hello accounts.google the student. So it basically helps me in the header only, like the HTTP header. It also helps me to provide some information like all those things, you know, the user email, the user Gmail, unique user ID that Gmail provides all or like us. So all of that thing, it basically, I can then print them as well. So you all can see this persistent ID and all those things. So yeah, I mean, that's it. Like this is what only you have to perform in the lab. But with this IAP, there was one like loophole or there was one concept you can say. So what will happen is basically, let's say someone can basically hard code these things as well, right? Like when I am not the actual person, I can simply, you all know, like when you send a post request, you all can simply just manipulate the headers somewhat, right? So when you manipulate them, you all can simply change these numbers, like change the organization name and all those things. But in order to, like, IAP also make sure that these things are not happening by something called as a signature. So you all can think of like your account as a fingerprint. Okay, so no one else can write this dummy data inside this because it will, like, the Gmail has some private keys, which when you have only logged in, then it will create it, and then using those private keys, it will create a signature. So once like that is done as well, so that is, it basically involves some cryptography and all those things. So all these things, like, you know, there is no way anyone else can come inside my organization. So that way IAP manages it all inside the Google this authentication part. So I hope like this part is clear. In this PPT, I have attached one very small video. I won't be showing it to you all right now. It's just for 1 minute. You all can see it later that they have showed a demo of, people are like trying to access the website, but they are not able to. And then after turning on IAP, they will be able to. So you all can, I'll attach this link in the Slack channel. You all can see that. And even when you'll perform the lab, you'll understand. So is the concept of identity aware proxy clear so that we can move ahead with the firewall part? Not exactly the token, because token will only, token only provides me the key, like just, key to go inside. But if I have like, I need a group of people to come inside that organization. So do you all know like what a VPN is, right? So basically what happens is many companies, they use VPN and all those things. So in like, this is one of the, you can say similar to VPN. If I'm not using VPN, if I have like created this IAP inside the my website, so that's fine. Like I can, basically it's simply like, you know, a group of users that can come inside or that can't. So not just JWT, you can say. I hope I cleared your doubt, Pankaj. And for Dhwani says yes, clear. And all, like for everyone else, any doubt or we can move ahead with the firewall. Okay, so this lab is basically facing some issues right now as well, but like by 1 or 2 days, it will not take you all more than 20-30 minutes. So this lab is very simple. So that's fine. I hope the concept was clear. So next concept is of firewall. I didn't get much time to attach anything. I'll see if I can draw anything. So like where this firewall concept came from is, you know, what happened was basically, let's say this is something like this is, let's just make a line here. Yeah. So let's say there is some fire in this part and this is a wall. These are the two rooms, or you can say a big basement with a wall in between. And let's say like I'm not much good in drawing. So let's say this. OK, rather let's write. So let's say this because of some power cut or something, the fire comes here, like the fire has come in this wall, this side of the wall, okay, this side of the room. But obviously, since there is a wall in between, the fire cannot, this fire, I hope this is clear, that this fire will not be able to pass or surpass this wall and go on the other side, right? So basically this wall was something that protected all the bad things happening on the left side and protected this right side. So firewall is nothing, firewall is this only, okay? So it is something that is between, this is my private network, like this right hand side that you see is my private network. It can be anything, like even my home network, or it can be some organization's network. So basically what this firewall will do is it will like anyone, like there are many hackers also, right? They try to come, like they have, if they find your IP address or anything, they try to come inside your network and they try to hack all those things. So what firewall will do is it will simply it will see, it basically works on packets. By now you all know what packets are, right? So packets are basically something that has source IP, destination IP, as well as the data on the port numbers and all those things. So now what I can do is basically, let's say I have all those things, right? So this firewall, what this firewall can do is it can simply, whatever the packets that of the data that are going on, it will see what the source destination is, what the where it is coming from. If I will have already made one table where I've already written that please don't take any entries from this IP, okay? So if there is any malicious or any of like that sort of IP, it will simply reject it and it will not let it come inside. So it will not let that fire come inside this private network, and it will save this private network. So even like when you all will go for internships as well, there will be what you all will have to do is, let's say it's a work from home part, like we all of us did that way. So if we need some access to go to some website, to the organization's website, we will have to first set up, like we will have to first request them that this is my VPN, please allow me to access the organization's website. So they will set up like those things for you. So like firewall is simply, if simply put, like in very simple language, it will help me to not like all the bad things not come inside my network, and it will secure my network. So it can happen two ways, either at the network level or at the host level. So when I say at the host level, it is basically preventing only my PC. When I say at the network level, so let's say there is one organization who has some network, right? So inside that network, there will be hundreds of other computers. So it will, not let that request come even inside that network. Okay. So if I have set the firewall rules at that network level, it will not let the host come inside, that request come inside to any of the hosts inside the network. Okay. And I think that's it. Like for firewall, this is it. This is what I wanted to cover. If someone has a doubt that what is the difference like between the firewall and antivirus, so I'll tell you all just like one or two sentences. You all can then search more about it. So basically this firewall, as I said, it looks at the source IP, destination IP and all those things. So it is working at the network level as well. And it is, antivirus and all those things, those only work on softwares, not the requests or not the API parts, right? So there is a difference between two of them. So don't mix between them. So was the concept of firewall clear? Like you all have been using it in your labs as well, and today you will be using it in this lab. So we thought to cover this concept. So was it clear? Can we like move ahead? Or any doubts? Just one person? Okay, then we will move to the part of subnets, and after subnets, we will see what VP, virtual private cloud, is. Shubhankar, you can continue.
Yeah, I'll just start sharing my screen. Someone confirm if my screen is visible.
Yes, it is.
Oh, okay, thank you. So good evening. I'll be covering IP addresses and subnets. Now, the main part is subnetting, but for that we require prior knowledge of IP addresses. And so that is what we'll be covering initially. So we'll be starting with what is an IP address, how does an IP address look like, what are the parts of an IP address, and then we'll move on to why subnets are necessary, right? So this is what is basically an IP address. An IP address is basically your identity in the internet, right? So every individual has an identity on the internet, and that is referred to by its IP address, right? So this is the IPv4 address. So that is 32, it's 32 bit address. It's divided into four octets, right? And separated by decimal points at every octet, right? So there's 8 bits, each 8 bit make an octet. And so like the address range is from 0.0.0.0 starting from all zeros to 255.255.255.255, right? All the 8 bits at one. And so that is the like maximum possible IPv4 address that you can get, right? So IP here stands for the internet protocol, right? So as you must be knowing earlier as well, that IP has two formats, the V4 and the V6. We aren't really concerned about V6, but we'll just look over what is an V6 address. So basically, the IPv6 address is of 128 bits, right? So the earlier was 32 bits and the version 6 address is 128 bits. So you can see what happens here, like the IPv4 address can access an address space of 2^32, right? So that every bit is 0 or 1, so there are 32 address bits and 2^32 address spaces. In the case of IPv6, there are 128 bits, so you can access an address space of 2^128. So that's a humongous amount of address space, and so basically it's all covered right now. This is just an introduction on IPv6 addresses. We won't be covering this, but yeah, just to have a know. Okay. So this is how any IP address is constructed. So there are 32 bits, again, remember that. And the 32 bits are then divided into two parts, that's network ID and host ID. The network ID, as is obvious, stands for the ID uniquely identifying any network. And the host ID is your individual host, right? If you are on a computer, so what's the IP that you will get? What's the ID that you will get? That is the host ID. So like every IP address is then divided into two parts. That's the net ID and the host ID. And they sum to 32 bits, right? So based on what's the net ID and what's the host ID, there are 5 different classes of addressing, okay? And this was pretty earlier, like this was up to 1990, it was very useful. And so we'll be using it now as well. So there are 5 classes of addressing, okay? And all of these classes are basically on the basis of what is the range of addresses in the first byte. The first byte is the first 8 bits of an IP address, right? So there are two, you can see there are two tables, right? Those are equivalent. One is in the binary notation and other one is the decimal notation. So the binary one is a bit easier to remember, and so that we use it to remember. So there are 5 basic classes of addressing, right? So whenever an IP address from this table, let's say, you can see the dotted decimal notation as well on the right hand side. Now let's say you are given an address of 192.168.43.1. So then you can say that the address is from class C, right? And suppose the IP address is 172.168 or something along that, so you can say the address is of class B, okay? So the starting decimal notation or the starting 8 bits uniquely determine every IP address into one of these 5 classes, right? So now what's the difference between all of these classes? So you see the part that is yellowed out, highlighted in yellow, represents the network ID, and all the other remaining octets represent the host ID. So you can see that class A has the first byte as network ID. So there are 256 network IDs possible, and all of the rest can be then used for the host ID, right? in class B, you have 16 bits for the network ID and 16 bits for the host ID. And class C, you have 24 bits for the network ID and 8 bits for the host ID. So you can see the number of hosts is getting reduced here, right? So once you get down on the classes, you can see that the number of hosts is getting reduced. And this is the choice that you make, that what type of address you should take in, right? So based on the number of hosts that you require, you can just like look whether a class B address is suitable or a class C address is suitable, or along those lines, right? So that is what is up to classful addressing. Okay, so I'll begin with classless addressing right now, but I would like to know if there are any doubts up to here. Like, have you all understood what is classful addressing? What are the 5 classes? So if you can just flip, or if you have any doubts, you can just put it up in the chat box. Okay, so I hope I'm audible, right?
Ankur, you're audible.
Okay. So, okay, seems to be no doubts. Okay. Well, then move on to what is classless addressing and why we need it.
I have a doubt. Can you explain what is host and network ID again?
Okay. So, like, basically every IP address should determine many unique points, right? So just as I said, that an IP address is uniquely representing any one computer on the entire internet space, right? So like what it should uniquely determine is on what network you are on, and if you are in that network, what is the host that you are on. So host here stands for the computer, right? So that's the, so every IP address is then like divided into two parts. It's just a logical differentiation, it's for identification, right? So that is the network ID and the host ID. So it's just two different like parts of an IP address. It's just used for uniquely determining, right? Okay, so then I'll move on to classless addressing. Now, like, there's a specific reason why classful addressing was it did not work in the market. It's because, like, let's say you want 254 hosts and this is like very close to 256, and like, so you want like up to 254 hosts, you should be able to use a class C address, right? Now let's say there are greater than 254 hosts, like what I did that here. So let's say you need greater than 254 hosts, you need a class B address to like uniquely represent every what should I say, every host, right? So what that does now is that you are using a class B address which has a host space of 2 raised to 16, right? You can see it from here that class B has 16 bits as host ID, and so 16 bits, like 2 raised to 16 is 65536, right? So among those, let's say you are using just 254 or just like even like 1000. So even if you're using 1000, it's an insane amount of waste space, right? You're not using those IP addresses, but you're still keeping those for yourself, and so those cost monetary transactions as well, and it's an insane amount of memory wastage, right? So to cope up with that, we introduced classless addressing, right? So this is now where we come to subnetting. What subnetting does is you have only one IP address right now. So earlier, let's say before subnetting, let's assume you required 4 networks, let's say. So what you would do is you would get 4 IP addresses and then you would just distribute and then like sort out stuff, right? So now in subnetting, you have one IP address and you can just spread it out over multiple networks, right? Again, this is a logical distribution, right? It physically does not exist, and this is just used for identifying. So you are the one who is going to distribute the host, right? You can see before subnetting, your entire IP address was divided into a network identifier and a host identifier, right? After subnetting now, you are splitting the host identifier into subnet identifier and the host identifier, right? So you are essentially dividing one IP address into many different networks. Okay, so that is the process of subnetting, which implies that you are just using one IP address for many networks right now, right? So like, see like how it is working currently. Let's say you have a single network that's the IP address 200.1.2.0, right? And this is the entire like address space that you currently require, right? So, and now what if you now need four networks of 32 space each, right? Not 32, I would say 256 by 4 is 64, I suppose. Yes. Okay, so let's say earlier you required a single network of 256 hosts. So you just decided that okay, 200.1.2.0 is the beginning of your network, and it will stretch up to 200.1.2.255. So those are 256 hosts that can be uniquely identified. That is a class C address right now, right? But let's say now you require four networks of 64 hosts each, right? So the total number of hosts that you need is still 256, but you cannot just like go around and devise four IPs right now, right? So instead, what you do is the existing IP address that you have, that is 200.1.2.02 to the last octet 255, you split it up into four pairs, right? So 256 divided by 4 gives you 64. So like you split the network into four pieces of 64 bits, 64 IDCs, right? So the first quarter represents 200.1.2.0. That's the subnet ID for the first quarter. The second quarter is at the bottom. That represents after 63 what happens. That's 200.1.2.64. Right, so the 64 there. The third quarter is the top right, that's up from 128 to 191, and the last octet is 192 to 256. So essentially, you had one single IP range of 256 hosts, you divided that into four subnetworks of 64 hosts each, right? That is what subnetting allows you to do. It achieves the level of achieves a level of hierarchy. You can just use one IP range to like evenly divide multiple networks, right? So how do we represent a subnet right now? Okay, so you just saw right now that we divided the entire address space that we had into four equal parts, but now we need a way to represent our subnet, right? And again, this is something that you must have seen already while specifying a firewall rule. For example, you whitelist every IP address, so you type 0.0.0.0/0, right? So the first four octets here, those represent the IP address, okay? And the second, after the forward slash, now we have a subnet mask. Okay, so now that we have a subnet mask, this IP address, the format of representing an IP address, now clearly identifies a subnet. Okay, so how it is represented now is that you have the starting IP address. Okay, so 192.168.4.12 is the starting IP address of your network, and you have a subnet mask of 24. Okay, so now we have a new term, subnet mask. Let's see what a subnet mask really is. Okay, so like, what a subnet mask essentially, or a mask essentially, like I skipped over what a mask is in the classful addressing, but a mask basically implies that it's all binary ones in the net ID, and since you are considering subnet, it's all binary ones in net ID and subnet ID, okay? So let's say you have a typical class A IP address, okay, so that's 0.0, or let's say 10.20.30.40. Its subnet mask will be 255.0.0.0. Now, recall earlier that the first 8 bits uniquely represent class A IP address, right? So I put all ones here, so that's 255.0.0.0. Similarly, if you have a class B address, so let's say 172.16.32.1, then you would have two octets completely filled. So that's 255.255.0.0, right? And finally, if you have a class C address, so let's say 192.168.43.1, so then you have like three octets completely full. So that's all ones in three octets, and that's 255.255.255.0. So again, note that this is just another IP address, right? And this is used as a subnet mask. It is a special value that is used to uniquely determine all of your subnetworks that you are creating, right? And so this is a general example of like class ABC. And now we introduce subnet masks. So what essentially these masks were, these were just like standard cluster address masks. Now we will extend this concept into subnet mask. Okay, so the forward slash notation again you'll be seeing right now, right? So I have three IP addresses here. They're all the same addresses. They have a different mask, right? So what is a mask now? Like just as I said earlier, a mask is all binary ones in the net ID and the subnet ID, right? So now the 25, 27 and 28 that you see on all the MSB bits, right? The most significant bits, that is the bits from the left side, are ones here. Okay. So when I'm writing 25, I'm specifying that all the 25 bits out of the 32 from the starting are ones. Okay. So the first octet has 8 bits, so that's 255. The second has 8 bits, so that's 255. The third has 8 bits, so that's 255. And the last octet has only one, the starting one as the starting bit as one, the rest all as zero, so that's 128, right? So that is the subnet mask for slash 25. Then next you have slash 27, right? Slash 27 again means that the 27 bits out of the 32 from the starting, from the left hand side, are ones, right? So that's 255 for the first 8, 255 for the second 8, 255 for the third 8, and then you have 3 bits left, right? So the MSB, 3 bits. So that's 128 plus 64 plus 32, that will give you 224. And for the last one, I've just given like how we are calculating the subnet mask. So see that there are 28, it's forward slash 28. So there are 28 ones here, right? So first octet is all 1, so that's 255. Second is 255, third is 255. And the fourth one is 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's 128 plus 64 plus 32 plus 16. So that's 214. So in this way, like given any IP address, you can now calculate the subnet mask. And using the subnet mask, you can then calculate what subnet it belongs to, what is the network ID, what is the subnet ID, like, right? So that is the special feature of then a subnet mask, that now earlier you needed an IP address to uniquely determine every individual. Now you need an address mask, an address, IP address, followed by a subnet mask. Okay. So now that we've reached like the end part of subnetting, there's three important points to note. First is that classful addressing does not exist right now. It does not exist in the sense that it's very not used right now frequently, and classless addressing is in demand. The second point is that it's not like classful addressing is totally lost, right? It's just a way of representation, right? How we were earlier representing, it's same. So the one on the top right is should remind you ideally. That classful addressing is just like a subset now of classless addressing, right? So I'll show you, I can't show you right now, but yeah. So what, like, let's say you have a class C address and you have a subnet mask of 255.255.255.0. Essentially, every IP address with a subnet mask of 24 will have this subnet mask, right? So now any class C address is just an IP address followed by a forward slash 24, right? Similarly, any class B address is just an IP address followed by forward slash 16, right? And so then you can say that class full address just got dissolved into classless addressing, right? And finally, we come back to why we needed subnets, right? Why we needed subnets was that we have multiple networks, and multiple networks have multiple hosts, right? And for like every network and every host, you need to assign an IP address that uniquely identifies them, right? So if you are in a single network and you have all the hosts, you can use a single IP address. But when you have multiple hosts, like multiple networks also, at that time you can use subnets to create a logical partitioning, right? And so then you should not go overboard on like creating subnets, because I'll go to a previous slide to explain why is this a bad idea. Because let's say you are having a class C address currently. Just a moment. What I was explaining was you should not go overboard in creating subnets, right? So you can see here that essentially you are just dividing the earlier host ID space into a subnet ID and another host ID, right? So when you're creating more and more subnets, you're reducing the number of hosts that you can uniquely have within each subnet, right? So let's say you had a class C address earlier before subnetting. So you had a host of 8 bits. So that means that you had one network of 256 computers, okay? So now you decide that you want 4 networks of 64 computers each. So you create a subnet like that, right? But then again, you decide that you want 8 subnets. But if you want 8 subnets, you should remember that now you have a lesser option, right? So now you can only have 256 by 8, so that's 32. So now you can only have 32 computers per network, right? So don't go overboard in creating subnets. That's the moral of the story. So yeah, so like that's all I have for in regards to subnet. If you have any doubts, you can just put up.
Should we continue, or is there any part that you want us to explain again?
Yeah, like any part that you did not get. Sab bouncer kya?
It's okay agar koi concept pura repeat karna hai to.
You all can just put up in the chat box, right? The chat box is open to all. Okay, then I guess we'll move on. Nikita, you can take up the next point.
Nikita, there is background noise.
There is?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. One second. Yeah, so now we will be covering just to give a review. We did identity aware initially. I'll just give you a quick revision of not the revisions as the concepts. We did identity aware proxy. We saw a few lab. Then we understood firewall. Then Shubhankar explained you all about subnets. Now finally we'll be moving to virtual private cloud. And after that, we will be doing the corresponding labs and relating all those things together. So, okay, before going on, what is a virtual private cloud when I say, okay? So one of the analogies that is very common to explain about this is basically, let's say you all are living in a city And you, but still, like anyone can come inside that city. Anyone can use the resources of that city, right? Anyone can use the like all the government given resources. But when it comes to like your own personal home, you all like it's something that's private to you. No, like no other person who is still living in the city, he can't access the home, the resources in your home, and all those things, right? So this is very similar. Virtual private cloud comes from this only. Like it's very similar to this analogy that let's say the city, like public cloud, like basically whenever I say I am deploying it to cloud, if it's not virtual private cloud, it's basically directly cloud, right? So but then what companies thought was like all the companies, they thought that everything is you know, all of these things are basically you can say like why like let's say imagine that what companies are doing right now is basically they are saying that it's a if it is not a virtual private cloud, they are saying that since it's a public cloud, how do we trust that some other company's resources is not able to see our resource? I am not able to trust you. Okay, so it is basically like then it came the concept of virtual private cloud, that inside this public cloud you all can make your own virtual private cloud for your companies that is only yours. Like you have the network IDs inside it also, like you all can consider this public cloud as the city and this as the home, your personal home where like no one else can come inside. Okay, so this was like about the little introduction to the virtual private cloud. And then like basically let's say, okay, first of all you need to understand that it's not that virtual private cloud is fixing some problem. It's not that now, even now, if I publish something to GCP by providing the IAM rules, all those things that we recently studied, it's not that it is not safe. Okay. It's just that virtual private cloud brings like one more layer of security, and it isolates one organization from another organization. It builds trust of companies on the cloud, as well as it is basically, you can imagine that let's say the company had its own infrastructure inside its like on-premise, but since we are like that infrastructure inside that company's server, instead of that it has it on cloud, and it in its own personal cloud. Okay, so like this is like it's not fixing any problem, it's just adding some layers of protection for my data as well. And yeah, so basically what VPC will do, it is basically it's combining two things. Okay, first of all, we all have like for until now we all have done the things like related to the public clouds, right? We have used the resources, we have tried to scale the resources on all those things, along with now VPC will give me a confidence that my data is isolated. I can use the network IPs and all those things to only you know, route inside my virtual private cloud, not knowing like anything that's happening outside the world. And if I want to know, if I want to communicate with some other virtual private cloud, I can do that as well. So since it's private, it's basically your home, right? It's private, it's completely under your control. I have the choice, you know, this for the network or this range, I'll come back to it later. Like there are two types, either I have a choice or I don't have a choice. Okay, so like it's up to me how I want. Like I want a IP address that is defined by me to be assigned to me, or I like ask for the cloud provider, okay, you give me some of your IP address, that is fine as well. Okay, so basically you get the control of what, okay, the subnet and all these things, I'll come back to it like in the next slide. So did you all understand like what VPC is doing? And also one more thing, if you all are thinking that we'll be using VPC all the time, that is wrong. I found this nice flow diagram from this website, so we will be going through this as well. Like it's not that I really need a VPC all the times. Okay, we will see when we don't need that, but like for now let's just understand what VPC is before going there. Now let's say, okay, so now the analogy of the house, that is clear, right? But after even like inside your house, it's not that you just have one room where you like, you know, you have the kitchen, you have your living room, you have your bedroom and all those things. Like it's not just like that one single room where you perform all the activities of the day, right? You have some separate rooms, you have a separate kitchen, you have a separate living room, you have a separate balcony and all that. Okay. So basically, even inside your home, you have all these things separated, right? So like, this is why I need inside the VPC, like inside my companies as well, I need it can be either like for my teams, like for different teams, I need different rooms, or you can think of it as, let's say, there is one like development subnet and there is one production subnet. All the data that is inside the development subnet, that is dummy, but that is everything that is inside the production subnet, that is the real data. So I can have different rooms for them as well. But most of the times, yeah, we create different VPCs also, like for that. But like it also depends on company to company. They decide to have different VPCs for these different things, or they have one VPC and inside that VPC they have these small different subnets where they those subnets have their own resources. Okay. We also one more thing to notice: VPC doesn't have VPC doesn't have its own IP address. If someone wants to like come inside the subnet that we understood, right? Shubhankar explained you all the concept of subnet. Obviously, I cannot afford giving a complete network to it. I can afford to give some range of IP addresses to one subnet. Okay, so that way it's all divided. So about all these things, if you think it is all going in the air, like what I am speaking for that, you just understand the concepts for now, then Ali will be like taking you all through the lab and then it will be more clear of how it works practically as well. Okay, so yeah, so in this website, it's just basically why like we are not having one big network. Why are we having subnets inside the VPC? It's because I need a separation or segregation between different teams and all those things. And basically, let's say my VPC is I assume that you all know like all these things. So let's say if I have taken a VPC whose network is this, so I'll be able to accommodate like these many IP addresses. And this is the this depends on the cloud providers, like it can be the 200 or this. So yeah, I think basically I tried to cover the concept of what VPC is and what is a subnet inside a VPC and how the subnet works, how the different teams will get different networks is using the concept of subnet again that you have studied it right now. And for this part, this is a simply okay. Before that, there is a concept of public subnet and private subnet. Okay, so let's say all your virtual machine where your server, where your instance, I'll monitor the chat as well if there are any doubts. Okay, no doubts. Are there any doubts? I'll wait before going to the next concept. Did you all understand the concept, or is there any doubt that we can solve? Anyone, any doubts or anything? Or if you all have understood, give a few yeses would do. Okay. Fair enough. We'll move ahead. Okay. So let's say by now we have not done anything fancy. We have just understood why we needed this concept of virtual private cloud. It is not important. We will see that when it is not important, but we need the concept of virtual private cloud and why it needs the subnets. I just told you all it in simple English terms. We will be seeing it in the lab as well. Now about the public and private subnet. So public subnet is basically anything from the internet. You all can see the internet gateway as well, right? So anything from the internet, they can communicate with the public subnet, but not with the private subnet. Private subnets are basically private, nothing from, unless I have added in my firewall or router rules it is not going to communicate with the outside world, okay? And when I say public subnet, you all can imagine it this way. Like in this subnet, there is like all the virtual machine instances where the servers are loaded, right? I have to show that to the world. But for the data, like my data is very precious. The cloud storage and all those things, those are inside this private subnet where I don't want them to, you know, communicate with the outside world. I want them, like, they can obviously interact with each other inside this subnet, but not with the outside world. So this similar type of architecture you'll be seeing in the lab as well. Okay, so this was an like these are the things that when I was reading things, like I most of the times read, so I have found them, like, so I have pasted it. So it says that let's say there is a subnet of SQL RTS databases within it. I can allow that communication like within inside this VPC, but I don't want that data obviously to go outside, like, okay, go outside the like towards the internet gateway. And yeah, if I have web servers and all those things, I have to open a lot of ports and all, reducing the level of security, because that's fine, like I am giving it to the outside world. And that is done, like public and private subnet part. And then we have, like, this is an example of setting up a subnet. So in this case, what is defined is basically I have a very simple virtual private cloud. Inside that cloud, I have defined like the region for that cloud is US East 1. I define the VPCs, I can define them like inside a region. And then what happens is inside that region, in US East 1, I have A, B, and C. So whatever are the availability zones, by availability zones, I mean, I'm able to access them as well, like using the IP and all those things. So whatever are the availability zones, my subnet like will be able to access them. So you all can see that this is like, as I said, the VPC does not have an IP address, right? The subnets have the IP address, the Shubhankar that explained, like Shubhankar explained you all that. So this was the IP that subnet has received. And then I have like, this is the network IP. And then I have like classified, or you can say, taken it down, like I have given one of the IP to this virtual machine and another IP to this virtual machine. So inside the subnet, like I have the subnet inside two zones, and inside these zones I have my virtual machines. So they, you can consider them as neighbors on the same subnet, and they can communicate with each other as well. Okay, so this was the concept of subnets. Also, like for GCP, there are two things. One of them, the two things can happen, right? I define what subnetwork, like this network that you can see, either I define like what I want for my companies, for my organization, as well as for my users to consider. Like if there is a load balancer, I want something that I want to decide. So that is done using, a custom mode, that it is like I have complete control over like how my subnets will be created, where my subnets will be created. And when I you all will be seeing this in the lab as well, you all will be creating the VPCs using these things. The another type is the auto mode VPC. Auto mode VPC mein kya hai? Basically, I get like, if it's done automatically by the GCP, you can say Google Cloud Platform. So basically, from whatever the region I have, there the subnets are created. But how all of this is done, if you want to know about that, you all can definitely read the blog on the official website. How many subnets, how many regions can have, how many zones I can have, how many subnets in one VPC and all those things. I think there is a maximum limit of some subnet. If you want to like exceed that as well, you'll have to ask for permissions. So this was about it. So this is basically like I was reading one this, and I found this very interesting. Like what happened was this is a very simple use case of how I need a subnet inside a VPC. Okay. They had created a public VPC, created one simple VPC with public and private subnets inside them. The public sub, okay. The public subnet would, what it will be able to do, it will be able to access the outside world, okay, the outside internet. Along with it, it will be like able to in that public subnet, as I said, we can create the web server and all those things, and the and whatever data I want to have in the private subnet. And so that is done. Now I have to like verify that this public subnet should be able to connect to the internet and I should be able to view the page. Okay, so two things can happen. Either it can like take up the URL. So when it comes to URL, it can either like that URL can route or come back to the IP that I have created using the either the custom mode or the auto mode parts. And like for the SQL server, I have to like connect it. Like you all must have done, I think this is in the WordPress wala lab. So you all must have created these things as well. So I'm just like hoping that if that time you all didn't understand this, like now it's clear. So basically, like from this web server, like what I did was I can connect to the SQL server. And I also like tried to make sure that this SQL server should not be able to connect to the internet. They, even though they can communicate, but this should not go outside the internet. Okay. So like to make sure all these things happen, I used this web server and this is in the private subnet. And okay. After that, like till here, I hope everything is clear. And then after that, I created a, so basically all these things, you know, NAT and all these things, you all can read more about that. But for now, you all can understand that what I have done like right now is I have allowed a few servers to two things can happen. Either the internet comes inside my private subnet or my private subnet can communicate with the internet. So what I have done is I have allowed a few servers to let my private subnet communicate with the internet. So after doing this, once I've done this, I tried to install MySQL since now MySQL server can communicate with them, right? But once I remove this instance of it communicating with the outside world, it should not work. Like even if I try to reinstall MySQL, it should not work because I have removed this instance. And so basically this was a very like simple lab to explain you all about this private and public networks as well. Lastly, before coming to this part, I hope these things are clear. Like what we did was a simple quick just overview of the slides is we understood about VPC. We did an analogy of that, like with the city, complete Mumbai city, you can say, and your personal private home inside that city. And again, that city, like home is also divided into different rooms for you can have like that way. And so that way, similar to that, we have VPC with public with public and private. Public and private subnet, you can also consider it as, you know, the living room. Like everyone can come in the living room, but like for the so all that thing, like you all can still and try to break it down if you all want to, but I think I have given a good analogy for that. And auto mode VPC and all is done. This was the lab. Now this thing, like even I was confused, you know, that like everyone says VPC and all, but do I really need a VPC all the times? So like this was a map that I found out, like if there are other private networks or also on there with whom I want to communicate with. So there's a concept called as VPC peering there. So yes, for that I need a VPC, but if no, so do I also need, like the VPC provides me a few more services as well, right? I can have my own IP addresses and all those things, NAT instance, firewall, routers, the ranges I can decide. So does my app really require those services? If that is yes, and I'm very sure about that, I need a VPC. Again, if that is like the answer is no, so it basically is saying that do I really need the like all those extra levels of security or that isolation that VPC provides? Like is it outweighing my if I take a risk of not doing that, is it also fine? So if it's fine, then okay, I don't need a VPC. But if I think, then I like need a VPC. So like these are the like whenever I need a VPC is when I want to communicate, when I want to, you know, use those services at a high level, or when I want those security controls, like those are priority to me. So then I can use. If no, then yeah, I don't use a VPC. So this was like all those theoretical things. We will be obviously understanding it more in the labs as well. So any doubts or anything, like if you all understood, or like I'll wait for a few seconds and then Ali will take for the lab. Any doubts? A few yes please, because like if they are not there, we will not be able to understand. why do we get a default subnet created for every region in each project? I had read that we need, okay, one second. I think I cannot read your complete message. One second. I had read in the documentation that we need at least one subnet to use a network. Okay. So Pankaj, for your second question, I'll answer that first. Tell me, how will you be able to access the virtual, all of your virtual machine resources or all of them if you don't have a network? You will obviously need a network, right, before doing all those things. How will I be able to we need net IP addresses for all those things, right, for communication, destination IP address. So if I am creating a virtual private cloud, there should be at least one network that I, that should be done, right? One network that the outside world can communicate with, or my VPC can internally communicate with. Without having at least one network, how will they communicate? It's basically, you're trying to say me that in this moment, complete city, there is there's no home. So what will be the use, right? If I don't have an address for that home as well, how will others communicate and all those things? For the first question, why do we get a default subnet created for every region? For this, even I am not sure, every region meaning not every region, I meant whatever the region I need the virtual private cloud to be in. For the details, how many and all those things, I will share you a link and we can read more on that there. Did I clear your doubt? I cleared your, I think the second part I tried to clear. For the first part, I'll send you the link and we'll read more about that there. So was it clear, Pankaj? Yes. So for all of everyone else, is it clear? A few yes or a few no or any doubts? Okay. Ali, you can take the lab, I think.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so that could be.
Ali, are you there?
Yeah, am I audible? Hello? Audible.
Okay, give me a moment.
Ali, if you are speaking, we can't hear you.
Hello? Yeah, am I audible now? Hey? Let me refresh. Hello, am I audible? Hello? Yeah, hello, am I audible now? Hello. Am I audible?
So professional.
He's rejoining. Till then, if anyone has any doubts. On even the concepts that Shubhankar or any one of us explained till Ali rejoins. I think he'll rejoin in a minute.
Hello?
You are audible.
Okay, I remember there was some audio. Cool. Is my camera on? No.
Okay.
Fine. Yeah, let me share my screen. Sorry for the audio issue. Yeah, so I hope my screen is visible. So just as a general reminder, whenever we create a VM instance, right, this was with respect to what Nikita was explaining. Whenever we create a VM instance, we always have two columns of IPs. One is the internal IP and one is the external IP. So the internal IP is basically like the private subnet or network IT, network IP which we have here, to which the particular VM is connected. And the external IP is the like a public facing IP through which you could, I mean, anyone could connect to the instance. So yeah, I mean, this particular thing is the IP of the internal network of the whole, your default subnet or default network. Yeah, so now once more, let me just recap a few things. Yeah, so basically any computer can be connected to multiple networks through NICs, which is like network interface cards. And as you can see in this particular diagram, this NIC0, like NIC012 as in the numbering, NIC0 is this particular IP. So the zeroth network to which it is connected to, it's connected via this particular internal IP. So in that similar sense, like we can have one particular in VM instance connected to many networks or subnets. And yeah, this is basically what you can specify while creating the instance. So there are a few, one second, I'll just go through this. Yeah, so first of all, we'll go through the VPC Networks Controlling Access Lab. I'll just give you all a brief overview of this. So in this particular lab, what we are going to do is we are going to create two instances, a blue server and a green server, having simple Nginx instances running inside them. And we are trying to see how we can control them and how VPC works. So first of all, we need to create a VM. So our standard procedure, navigation menu, compute engine, and then VM instances. And then we will click on create instance. And our standard values, I mean, generic values, name, region, zone, etc. And then generally we skip this particular part, but then there is a dropdown which has this management, disks, networks, networking, etc. options. So here we are interested in the VPC and the networks. So we will go to networking, and here we will have multiple options of network type, tabs, network instances, interfaces, etc. So network interfaces is basically the NICs of that particular VM instance, and you can specify which networks do you want that interface to be connected to. So by default, our VM instance is connected to the default network, which is a private network connected to that particular Google Cloud project. So no other project can access that. And as a small aside, there are a few reserved IP address ranges or IP masks for such internal addressing, and you are allotted one of them. Reserved in the sense like no public IP is present on that particular network range, which is specifically 10.142 something, one is 168 dot something, and one is 192 dot something. So yeah, that's not important, just as an aside I said that. So yeah, you can actually specify the network tags of that VM instance, and you can specify the network interfaces, that is, which networks do you want to connect to. And here, if you have VPCs, if you have subnets, then you can add multiple and you can edit them also. So here, what we are trying to do is, we are going to create a blue instance, a blue server. Yeah, blue server. And we are going to connect it to the default network. And as a network tag, which is basically something which identifies computers on a network. So like we had tags in Kubernetes, Docker, etc. Similarly, like just to identify your VM instances or VM instances here, containers in Docker. So you just have to tag them. So you can identify those VM instances using these network tags. So for now, we are going to tag that as web server. We'll just see how important this web server network tag is and what is the use of that tag. Okay, once we've created this, then we are going to create a green server. And here we are not going to specify the network tag of a web server. And yeah, just now setting up everything. So as we can see, we will have two instances, both of them having internal IPs and external IPs. Okay, and you can see NIC, they are connected to the same network through NIC0. And now just simply to differentiate their output, we are going to SSH into them. We are going to install Nginx, and we are also going to change some text, like the default page. It has welcome to Nginx, and in the blue server, we are going to change that to welcome to the blue server. And in the green thing, we're going to change that same thing to welcome to the green server. Like just to differentiate their output whenever we hit them. So once this is done, so your two instances are set up, blue and green, both are in the default subnet, and like both of them have Nginx installed. And on hitting the main or default page of the blue server, we are getting welcome to blue server. And on hitting the default page of the green server, we are going to get welcome to green server. So this is like our initial setup. And now what we are going to do is firewall, create a firewall rule. So as Nikita said, like firewall rules are just like are intended to protect your network or your PC against unintended access on specific boards or by specific IPs. So typically in a firewall rule, you can specify a few things, which is if the rule is for incoming traffic or for outgoing traffic, also known as ingress as incoming and egress as outgoing traffic. And you can also specify which ports, you can also specify which protocols, and you can also specify which IP addresses are able to access. So now what we're going to do is we're going to create a firewall rule. And here what we're going to do is create a firewall rule that applies to VM instances with the web server network tag. So in the like we can have multiple firewall rules, right? And we have multiple instances. So we need to specify which firewall rule is applicable for which instance. So here is where network tags come into picture. You can actually specify that this particular firewall rule is applicable for all VM instances having this particular network tag. So we had tagged the blue server with the web server network tag, and we are going to basically create a firewall rule for that. And yeah, we already have an internal, a default firewall rule, which is default allow internal. So this is basically inside your default VPC, all the ports and all the protocols are allowed. So like internally, there is no issue of any conflict or any blockage. You can freely access all the resources internally. Internally in the sense through the internal IP address. Now we are going to create a firewall rule, and we're going to specify that in the default network, and we are going to say for the specified target tags, which is like the web server target tags. And we need to specify what protocols are accepted. So these are the protocols. We are allowing ICMP, we are allowing TCP at port 80. So for those who don't know, TCP at port 80 is basically our HTTP protocol. So we are going to allow HTTP traffic. And you need to also specify sources, right? So you need to specify that which IP addresses are allowed to access this. So in our filter, we are going to specify source IP address as 0.0.0.0/0. Now this is a subnet having, as Shubhankar explained. So this is a subnet which is basically encompassing all the IP addresses in the whole world. So any IP address can access this particular instance with the protocol of TCP80 or ICMP. So we have created the firewall rule. Any doubts still here? If no doubts, please say yes. No doubts, no yeses. I'm hoping. Cool. Thank you, Akshat. Cool. Okay, so I'll move ahead. Right, and now what we are going to do is we are going to create a third virtual machine, which will be named TestVM. And that is again a simple virtual machine, like with our default values, nothing special about it. So, where is it now? Yeah, so this is our final diagram of the whole thing, right? This is our default VPC. We have a blue server, we have a blue instance, we have a green instance, and we have a test virtual machine. All of them are connected together to the same network, which is the default network inside the default VPC. Okay, and all of these have internal as well as external IP addresses. So this particular point will be NIC0 for the green instance. This will be, for example, NIC0 for the blue instance, and this will be NIC0 for test VM. So all three of them are in the same network, which is our default network. And as we had seen, the default network had a particular firewall, which basically allowed all connections to this. So we can easily access the blue as well as green instances from the test VM via the default network. So now we are going to actually do that. We are going to SSH into this test VM. And we are going to try to connect to the green and blue networks, green and blue instances. And we are going to do that through curl. I hope you all must have used curl at least once in this whole session. I mean, this whole track. So curl is basically like simple for our get and post requests or any other web requests. So we are going to ping this particular internal IP of the green. First we're going to do that for the blue. It doesn't matter, actually. The order doesn't matter. We're going to curl the blue's internal IP, and we are going to check the output. And we would be able to see the welcome to the blue server header, which is basically meaning that our connection to blue is basically like we could easily and properly connect to blue. Same thing for green. And we will see that both of these are easily accessible because you are on the same network with the proper firewall rules which allow the access. Now, what we are going to do is we are actually going to connect to the external IP addresses of each of them. So this is what is going to take place. This was our default network, and we were able to access the instances through the default network. And now we are going to access them through the external IP addresses. Now, since we had specified in a firewall rule, right, that for the blue instance, we are allowing TCP 80 access. So we will be able to curl into this, and we will be able to see the proper output. Whereas for the green one, if you try to connect, then because there is no proper firewall setup, we won't be able to access that, and we won't get the proper output. Okay, any questions? So this was like the basic overview of VPC and what and how the internal external IP addresses work, how our NICs work, etc. If you have any doubts, then please ask, because we are going to move on to a bit more complex lab now. So I will assume no doubts. There is one part left here. I'll come back to this later on. First, let us move to the multiple VPC networks lab. Okay, so I hope you all can see this complex and big diagram. Okay. So, like part of in this lab, like part of this setup is already made for us, and part of it is what we need to make. But that's like simple. You have proper instructions how to do that. So I'll just explain the architecture of this whole thing. So basically, here we have two private networks, two VPCs. One is named My Network. This whole thing. The color is this reddish greenish color. This is the whole VPC, my network VPC, and we have it across two regions, US Central 1 and Europe West 1. So now this clearly indicates that there is no restriction in the VPC. We can clearly have a VPC covering multiple regions. And we have two subnets in that particular VPC. This US Central 1 subnet and the Europe West 1 subnet. Similarly, we have another VPC named as PrivateNet. And again, a similar configuration here. We have two subnets, US Central 1 and Europe West 1. And a third VPC, which is basically management VPC, having only one region, US Central 1. Okay. So according to this, now we can clearly see that since both of these are in the same VPC, we can easily connect through them. Like, this is what we'll try to do during the lab, and we will prove that this works. We will be able to connect through these two because they are in the same VPC. And this particular VM, we are basically, now what we are going to do is, this is our VM appliance, which is basically like our test VM in the previous lab. And we are going to try to connect to all of these. And we will see, like, according to the firewalls we specify, this is how we are going to connect to them. Cool. Okay, I hope no doubts. There's one small concept, I'll just explain that. Just a minute. Yeah, so as I was saying, right, that one particular VM can be connected to multiple networks. So that is what we're going to do with this particular VM appliance. We are going to have three networks for this, one connected to US Central 1 with NIC0. One connected to this subnet with NIC2 and one connected to this subnet with NIC1. So this particular VM appliance will actually be connected to three subnets and in turn through to these three VPCs because the subnets lie in those VPCs. And you all will be able to see that. You all will be able to see NIC 0, 1, 2, all three specified in the internal IP address. And for those who have used ifconfig, which is the configuration of your internet interfaces, they are actually going to do that, and we will see that we have three connections and having three different IP addresses for the same. There was one small thing, wait. Yeah, so we are going to SSH into VM appliance and we are going to try to connect to the other VMs. So PrivateNet US VM's internal IP, which is basically PrivateNet US VM, we are going to connect to this. And since we are connected to the same network and we have the proper firewall setup, we will be able to connect. Yeah, this is basically DNS. I think you all will get it while reading this. So instead of the internal IP address, you can actually specify the instance name. And we have an internal DNS network, which is a domain name service, which is running. And we will be able to just specify the instance name instead of the IP address. And your DNS service will resolve this instance name to the proper IP address. And we will be able to connect to this. This is like what they are trying to explain here. And management net US is US VPN, mynet US VM. So this thing, management net US, we will be able to connect to this. And where was it? Yeah, mynet US. So we will be able to connect to all these because of this, because this VM appliance is connected to all three networks using the three interfaces. So this thing, the last thing, mynet EU VM's internal IP, we're going to try to connect to Europe's VM, mynet EU VM, which is this one, yeah, mynet EU VM. So now if you all can see, right, this is a different subnet, this is a different subnet, and this VM appliance is basically connected to this subnet, the US subnet, not the Europe subnet. Okay, and we are connected through NIC1. So this is a bit of an advanced concept, but for those who know of routing tables and stuff, so each computer has a basic routing table, and first of all it will try to connect to the computers and the networks it is connected to. If that is not possible, I mean the destination IP is not in the same subnet as a computer, then it tries to go through any of one of the subnets and like takes a hop inside the subnet and then goes forward. So that is basically by default configured to NIC0. So since this instance is not in the same subnet as our VM appliance, it will try to connect through one of these subnets, and by default it tries to connect through this subnet, which is the NIC0 subnet. And since this subnet is also not connected to this subnet, we will actually not be able to connect to this particular subnet. A fairly advanced concept for those who do not know IP addresses, routing tables and routing mechanisms. But anyway, I mean, this is a small little thing, so if you all will read it, I mean, the second years will definitely have this in their third year in SEM 5. So any doubts till now? I'm assuming no response, like Linux means a positive response. Okay, thank you, Akanksha. Yeah, and finally coming back to the first lab, which was exploring network and security admin roles. So yeah, in the IAM lab, right, we had seen, and the whole concept of IAM, we had seen that how administration and other permissions can be given to different users. So this concept is a bit similar, but there is one small concept, I believe, which was not covered anywhere. So where is that? Yeah, this is a concept of a service account, right? So generally in IAM, we have users, right? So this particular email address or this particular user has these permissions. So similar to users, we also have service accounts, which are basically not users, but we can actually consider them as what would I say? I would call them as virtual users inside your project. So these service accounts can be connected to any resource, or in fact, like any resource can be given the permissions, can be associated with a particular service account, and that particular resource will have the permissions of that granted to that particular service account. So here we are going to do that, and inside the same thing, like I am an admin, and instead of users, we are going to go to service accounts, and we are going to create service accounts, and we are going to give them permissions. We are going to give them network admin permission and security admin permissions, or roles, sorry. Where was it? One second. Yeah, so network admin, basically that network admin role has these permissions to create, modify and delete our networking resources, except for firewall rules and SSL certificates, because those are like much more important than our normal networking stuff, because they are essentially related with security, and hence that role is given only to the security admins. So in this last part, what we're going to do is we're going to create the service accounts having network and security admin roles, and then using those service accounts we are going to modify the network and security permissions. I mean, simple enough, so I'll not go much into detail. You can see the whole steps. This is like more of like how to do it rather than the theory. Okay, so we have covered two labs. One is VPC networks, controlling access, and the other is multiple VPC networks. And we have one last lab, which is basically a combination of firewall rules, VPCs, and load balancers, and instance groups. And we have covered all these concepts in different sessions, so I'm not going to go through this. Uh, Okay, I think we are done with the session if no one has any doubts.
Thank you, Ali. Just to share one slide. So in this doc, I had mentioned that resources from the cloud team. Day one, I had shared this PPT with all of you. And as you can see, these are some of the videos. All these videos can be found on Google Cloud Platform's YouTube channel. So if you want it to be explained, there are many playlists here, so you can explore them as well. So I have mentioned that in the doc, and other things are just, as you all know, the recordings of previous sessions and all. So this was ideally the last session, and after that, if you have any doubts, we have the Slack channel available, and I hope all of us will complete the labs. Lastly, thank you to all of us who are managing college and teaching and coming to attend. So good session for all of us for the first time. Thank you.